Tokyo, the bustling cyberpunk metropolis that never sleeps, home to clunking trains, growling expressways and bustling crowds. Sydney, the relaxed beach city, home to chill harbours, lovely bushwalks and leafy suburbia. Or so they'd have you believe.
See, when I visited Japan in December, I met famous celebrities such as Mario Jumpman Mario and Monkey D. Luffy. I became a samurai, and I also discovered that two Australian icons, the most famous celebrities we have, actually did advertising work in Japan. But the biggest discovery I made
was that it was actually a lot quieter than Sydney.
While we're here enjoying the peace and quiet of Tokyo, I'd like to take a moment to thank my Ko-fi supporters. Lucas, Adam Takesi Dung, Stuart Vich, Arx Walia, Abram N, Michael Gribben, Trisha Chakos, Sharath Mahendran, Tarkon, Joe Burton, and Ben Messer. Welcome to Footpaths and Corner Stores. My real full name is Chris Topher. Remember to subscribe to make sure no more kaiju attack Sydney. This is something I genuinely have the power to prevent. So, back to Japan.
I got a good night's sleep every night, and I navigated the streams of people on Tokyo streets with kind of calm zen that I wasn't really expecting. Sure, the stairwell of Don Quixote just completely shattered that illusion when I needed to buy some beard oil. You know, things did get quite a bit louder when those vans blaring out political slogans during election time came around, but you know what, on the whole, I was actually really pleasantly surprised by, you know, this strange but really pleasant coexistence of thousands and thousands of people going about their day and the kind of calm quiet that went along with it all. When I got back home to Sydney, I started to do some research into how they pulled this off. And that's going to be the topic of this video. We'll get into that in a bit. But first of all, I want to spend a moment talking about why this is actually important. According to the Bruntletts in their excellent book, Curbing Traffic, in most societies, noise is seen simply as a byproduct of growth. This has coincided with a gradual retreat from the public realm, which means many people now pass through rather than remain in public space and see it as the job of others to look after it. See, when I lived in Sydney, I lived on a major arterial road and to be honest, it was absolutely filthy with litter all the time. Meanwhile, in Tokyo, there was seriously not a speck of litter anywhere, and I even saw people sweep leaves from the footpath in front of their house or their shop. Now, part of this, no doubt, comes down to cultural things and specific litter-related governmental policies. I mean, kids in Japanese schools, you know, clean up the school at the end of their day, so cleanliness is obviously a big part of the culture. Maybe something we could be paying a little bit more attention to in Australia. Even within Japan, I noticed that there was a link between noise and litter. The noisier cities like Osaka had the most litter. Whether this is correlation or causation, I don't know, but there definitely seems to be a link there. Now, there's also the fact that noise pollution can have significant health impacts on the people exposed to it. Different sounds can create different stress responses in people based on factors like pitch. But for road traffic, which is what I'm going to be focusing on for most of the video, the World Health Organization recommends
an average of less than 53 decibels.
Some of the health concerns related to exceeding this level of noise include high blood pressure, heart disease, stress, mood swings, lost sleep, diminished productivity, hypertension, depression, and hearing loss. And especially in terms of lost sleep, even if you feel like you're tuning these noises out at night, you're not. Research based on measuring physiological reactions suggests that no habituation to noise takes place, even though self-reports of sleep study subjects indicate a degree of habituation to noise. Okay then, well, if noise is so bad, why do people not just move to quieter areas? Secondhand noise, like secondhand smoke, is discharged into the environment without consent from the soundproof cabin of a car, and those of lesser economic means are disproportionately the ones left struggling with its fallout. This is largely due to houses being on noisy roads, leading to cheaper rent prices, leading to people who can't afford a whole lot renting there, and this is only exacerbated by the housing crisis in Sydney at the moment. I hope I don't have to say this, but no matter where someone lives, we should all have access to a healthy standard of living. So how can we achieve this? Well, I've done a bit of research into how Japan achieved it, and I'm going to specifically focus on roads because that tends to be the biggest noise polluter in cities aside from maybe construction sites, which Japan regulates with decibel meters, something I saw in Kyoto while I was over there, but that's a conversation for another time. So, how does Tokyo maintain quiet? Well, it's not really a mystery at all. The New South Wales Environmental Protection Agency actually knows everything it needs to do to make noise pollution a thing of the past, and it has all of the steps outlined in a really handy document. We just haven't acted on them. And that's the biggest difference between Japan and Australia noise pollution wise. Australia's paid these things a little bit of lip service, tried to look like they're doing something by talking about what they need to do. Japan just does it. Let's speed run the first few of these EPA recommendations. Number one, investigating changes to transportation. The example the EPA gives is shifting freight from road to rail, which, you know, anyone who's ever heard a truck use its compression braking knows is a fantastic idea for limiting noise pollution. 79% of Australian domestic non-bulk freight is moved by truck, a much higher percentage than Japan. This is also high compared to other more comparable countries to Australia, like the USA. The reason for Australia falling behind in this department is that our regional railways are just really, really bad. Number two, promoting the use of low noise pavement surfaces and further researching these. Research isn't actually needed. We already know what works. In 2005, the Tokyo Metropolitan Government began the standardization and full-scale introduction of double-layer low-noise paving. Now, part of this was to lower noise pollution, but a big part of it was something that would be really helpful in Australia as well. This particular kind of paving actually reduces heat because the asphalt absorbs more water and therefore it evaporates more water into the air when it's hot, and therefore it cools the air. Australia's done a few trials, most notably in Queensland, with similar substances for paving roads, but it's never gone beyond that level. What we need to do is what Japan has done. We need to actually say, okay, this is the standard. We're going to regulate asphalt to be low noise, double layered pavement. Number three, improving the quality of public transport services and expanding public transport networks. Now, you don't need me to tell you that Tokyo has one of the best subway systems in the world. But to be honest, Sydney's is pretty good. And you know what? It's getting even better with all the excellent metro projects being built. I lived in Epping for a bit, and let me tell you, the metro up there is fantastic and is going to be a game changer when it comes to inner Sydney and goes out to Parramatta. It's going to be fantastic. Number four, expanding cycle and pedestrian facilities and increasing their attractiveness. Something that surprised me about Tokyo was that it had extremely high rates of cycling and active transport, despite having basically no infrastructure for it. When I rented a bike and rode around Kyoto, and also just observing people cycling around different cities in Japan, it became pretty clear what the reason for this is. Dense mixed-use land use that means you're never far away from your destination, or at the very least train station. Really low speed limits, narrow roads that naturally enforce these low speed limits, and also smaller cars that are much less threatening to people walking and cycling. Australia could very easily implement lower speed limits and bring itself more in line with the vast majority of the developed world. That is, could implement 30 kilometers per hour on local roads and high streets, and then 50 kilometers per hour on major arterials. These slower speed limits would also lower noise pollution from tire friction and increase safety significantly with very little speed lost. Australia's made a few steps towards implementing this. Inner West Council recently decided to make its default speed limit 40 kilometers per hour. City of Sydney has already done this. Marybeck Council in Melbourne is trialling 30 kilometer an hour speed limits, but it's just not standard yet. I'm sure within the next decade though, it will become standard. As for density and mixed land use, we're actually heading in the right direction with a lot of our responses to various housing crises around the country. New South Wales and the ACT are both implementing upzoning laws. You can have your say on them here. Number five, ideally locating residential development away from major roads and locating centres and main streets on streets branching off or parallel to major roads for improved amenity. Organisations like the Heart Foundation have brought this to the attention of the Australian Parliament, but we just keep building our high-density housing along busy arterial roads.
For example, the newest and most progressive greenfield development in Canberra, Ginninderra, which features bike lanes and lots of traffic-calm streets with plenty of walking space and street trees, still locates its higher-density housing near its major arterial road, Prohard Avenue.
I think this comes from this weird view that the old and wealthy have of high-density housing, that it's only for the desperate and that no one in their right mind would want to live in a townhouse or an apartment. And so, you know, if people are desperate enough to live in medium or high density housing, then they're desperate enough to live on an arterial road. And, you know, this is dressed up with excuses like the fact that arterial roads can take more traffic, ignoring the fact that for a road to be efficient, it should have as few entrances and exits as possible, i.e. driveways. But the fact is, low density housing works far better on busy arterial roads than high density housing. With low density housing, the houses can be further set back from the road. There'll be fewer driveways and fewer cars exiting and entering the road with these driveways. There will be less building materials, less surfaces needed to insulate against the noise. Meanwhile, medium and high density actually works really well on local streets. It makes already calm and walkable streets more walkable by adding more destinations and more people walking from their houses. And for those that do drive in these higher density developments, which tend to have less car parking per person than the low density developments, well, they'll be exiting their driveway onto a calm, safe street where they don't have to worry about being hit by a high amount of fast moving traffic. And finally, point number six, and this is one that I'm going to get into in a little bit of detail. This is the one I went down a real rabbit hole with when I was researching. Developing hybrid and electric light and heavy vehicles with lower noise emissions. As I did some research, I found that this was something that Australia was seriously falling behind on, like a lot. This is kind of like the low noise pavement, where despite the EPA talking about things needing to be developed, that's just not the case. We already have all the technology we need. 43% of Japan's cars are hybrid or electric, compared to only 8% in Australia. Australia does do some things really well as far as electric vehicles. I mean, we've got those great electric buses in Sydney's inner west. But that being said, focusing only on the hybrid or electric component of this is missing the bigger picture. You see, it's only at low speeds, i.e. around 30 k's an hour or slower, that having an electric vehicle or a hybrid vehicle over an internal combustion engine actually makes a really big difference with noise pollution outside of large vehicles. The reason for this is that at 30 kilometers an hour or higher, most vehicle noise comes from friction between the tires and the road. And therefore, the two most important factors are number one, pavement, which we've already mentioned, and number two, how heavy the vehicle is. Both of these factors significantly impact the friction when the tire meets the road.
So then how does Japan actually encourage smaller vehicles? What does it do that Australia doesn't? Let's compare the approximate yearly cost of a 2023 Ford Ranger in Japan versus Australia. All of these numbers have been converted to Australian dollars in March 2024, which may impact some things, but the differences are big enough that you should get a pretty good idea of how different these systems are anyway. We'll start off with tonnage. At first, it seems like Japan's a lot cheaper. It charges $170 per year for the Ford Ranger weight range, whereas Australia charges $546. But Australia's tonnage tax is more equivalent to Japan's engine size tax for the Ford Ranger. That would be 520 AUD per year. And Australia doesn't even have an equivalent to this engine size tax. So it ends up being more expensive in Japan. Now, parking is highly variable, but from what I could find on average, it can cost about $12,000 a year to park a vehicle in Japan, and you actually have to prove that you have the space and the money to do this. I calculated the Australian parking costs based on the fact that parking adds approximately $100,000 to the price of property, and then that translates to about an extra $100 rent. So I haven't included for Australia or Japan parking near your work if you drive to work or anything like that. This is purely storing the vehicle at home. Japan does their safety inspection every 2 years, Australia every year. I've adjusted the numbers to make up for that. These are just approximate. It depends on which mechanic you go to, but you can see that there's such a huge difference there that the mechanic probably doesn't make a massive difference. This all adds up to Japan costing $13,316 a year just for these fees, compared to Australia's $5,792. And if we take out parking, that still comes up as almost double Australia's yearly costs. An additional note about parking.
Japan also doesn't have government paid for parking like Australia does. In Australia, we have a lot of free street parking and free surface lots paid for by taxes and council rates. A kind of hidden cost to the everyman that makes it artificially cheaper for car owners to store their vehicles. Japan's model incentivizes less car ownership, but also the ownership of cars that are smaller and
emit way less tire friction noise. If we did increase some of the charges on heavier vehicles to be more in line with Japan, we should also introduce small cars with cheaper registration costs.
Now, obviously, when it comes to vehicle size in Australia, we have to mention the elephant in the room. Tax breaks for wealthy people who want to buy giant vanity utes. Australia's most popular car of the year for 2023 was the huge, loud, heavy Ford Ranger, while Japan's most popular car of 2023 was a sensible city car, the Toyota Yaris. This brings it back to an issue of social justice. See, the cheapest new Ford Ranger is like $36,000. I mean, when I was driving Ute around as a gardener, I sure as heck did not drive a Ford Ranger. No, these American trucks are toys for rich people who are trying to convince us that they do actual work, and no one's buying it. And I know I'm gonna get this comment, so I just wanna jump in here and say, this has nothing to do with Australia being more rural than Japan, because Australia is not more rural than Japan. Both countries are about 90% urban. The main difference is that Australia's rural population is way more spread out than Japan's. This just makes the case for fuel-efficient vehicles. But don't worry, I do have some good news. Australia recently dropped the spending cap for this tax break from $65,000 to $20,000.
Barely enough for a pizza delivery hatchback,
according to drive.com.au, who have apparently never heard of 10 to 20 pizza delivery e-bikes, which are the normal way to deliver pizza.
That's why I'm joining Domino's, to bring land back to the people.
So I guess next year we'll see if the reduction of this tax break impacts the size of Australia's most popular new car. But there's another key thing that Australia's government is consulting on right now: fuel efficiency standards. Australia is the only developed nation besides Russia that does not have fuel efficiency standards. Because of this, Australians pay far more for fuel than people in other countries, despite the fact that our fuel excise is actually really, really low compared to most OECD countries. We also have much bigger cars than other countries, aside from maybe the USA, where fuel efficiency standards exist, but utes and SUVs are exempt. Our cars also spew way more pollution into the air. Our lack of fuel efficiency standards is also part of the reason that we have barely any electric and hybrid vehicles in Australia as well. The car companies don't have to sell their innovative, exciting, cutting-edge vehicles in Australia. They all go to the EU and Asia, where the fuel efficiency standards are and where there are incentives for them to sell these cutting-edge vehicles. And then they just dump all their big old polluting garbage in Australia. The result of this is that the EU has over 200 types of EVs available, while Australia only has just over 50 options. So, what can you do? Well, I would strongly recommend writing to your government about whichever of these issues affect you the most. You can write to your local government for parking and increased active transport infrastructure like bike lanes. And most local governments also have a portal specifically for noise complaints. That being said, most of them are designed around ratting out your neighbors for having a party, so maybe they're not that useful for this. You could also go a level higher and write to your state government about better public transport and that sweet, sweet low noise pavement. But the thing that is the most timely and most important if you live in Australia is the fuel efficiency consultation the federal government is currently undertaking.
It took me so long to edit this video around my new full-time job that the consultation ended well over a month ago, but I think there's still room for action on this one. The government presented three options for the fuel efficiency standards: A, making the least change, B, in the middle, C, making the most change.
I recommend going with option C. It's the option that will bring in the most fuel efficient cars that will be the quietest and least polluting to run.
But the government did end up deciding to go with option B. That being said, this is a staged rollout of fuel efficiency standards, so if you continue to write to the Transport Minister in favour of option C, if the rollout of option B is going well and there's enough support for option C, it is always possible that the government might up the ante.
And you know what? Who knows? Maybe in a decade or two, Australia will have roads and cars that are as quiet as Tokyo's if we play our cards right now. If we take that quietness, that peacefulness, and we combine it with our love for street trees, our fantastic beaches and parks, then our cities will seriously become some of the best in the world, even more so than they are already.